friends.
Good evening, Pastor Carr.
Welcome to worship. This is, let me see, we're all the way on the 15th Sunday after Pentecost. We get it after Pentecost. Good to be here gathered with you in the name of our Lord Jesus Christ here tonight. We have finished the sermon request for this. We're actually doing one last sermon request for my wife tonight, which is not on a certain topic, it's just something quick, she said. So tonight's sermon is nice and short and to the point for you. You're welcome, man. Yeah. So let's see, a couple of announcements for you tonight. As we get started, I want to remind you that our new women's Bible study class is starting this upcoming Wednesday. That's September 8th, down in the parish hall, starting at 5:45. If you would like information on that or materials, reach out to Helen Huger for that. We do have the new portals of prayer available for you. In the narthex, David says they're autumnal colors, which I love that word. Yeah, it's a nice lot of it. We're heading into the best time of year. So grab those on your way out. Grab it for a friend. I'll keep reminding you that we have those available. We also have custodian positions available for our campus. I've told you about that a couple times. If you want more information about that, I can see Rex right there. You can probably ask him. Reach out to John Stowes, one of our trustees. But just a reminder for that. You know, somebody might be interested. Tomorrow we will have a gardener's market open between the services. So if you're around, if you're at a church, come down and join us for that. Yeah, right after the first service, we'll get that started. Anything else, David? Do you have anything else?
No school on Monday.
Oh, no school, yeah.
That's a disappointment.
Woo! Yeah. Oh, yeah. Sorry for the disappointment. Yeah. We're going to celebrate Labor Day. So, no school on Monday. But if you're part of the Zoom Bible study, I'll see you on Monday morning. We're still going to meet. So, yeah. I think that's it in terms of announcements. Our Lord Jesus is here, even in his true body and blood tonight, to give us what he promises. Forgive us of sins, the strengthening of our faith. Let us stand. We'll open with our first song.
Show me your ways, O Lord. Teach me your paths.
Guide me in your truth and teach me. For you are God, my Savior, and my hope is in you all day long.
Against you, you only have I sinned and done what is evil in your sight. So you are right in your verdict and justified when you judge.
Surely I was sinful at birth, sinful from the time my mother conceived me. Yet you desire faithfulness even in the womb.
Turn us again to you, O God, and call and cause your face to shine upon us. Then we shall be saved.
For the sake of your name, O Lord, forgive my iniquity, though it is great. Have mercy on me, O God, according to your unfailing love, according to your great compassion. Blot out my transgressions, wash away all my iniquity, and cleanse me from my sin. For I know my transgressions, and my sin is always before me.
Brothers and sisters, in his amazing love for you, our God has heard your confession. By his command and the authority he gives to his church, forgive you all of your sins in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. For it is by grace you have been saved through faith, and this is not from yourselves, it is the gift of God, not by works, so that no one can boast.
For we are God's handiwork, created in Christ Jesus to do good works, which God prepared in advance for us to do. Amen.
We sing in response. Say to to those with fearful hearts, be strong, do not fear. Your God will come. He will come with vengeance, with divine retribution. He will come to save you. Then will the eyes of the blind be opened and the ears of the deaf unstopped. Then will the lame leap like a deer, and the mute tongue shout for joy. Water will gush forth in the wilderness and streams in the desert. The burning sand will become a pool, the thirsty ground, bubbling springs. Our epistle reading tonight comes from the book of James, chapter 2, selected verses. James writes, "My brothers, as believers in our glorious Lord Jesus Christ, don't show favoritism. Suppose a man comes into your meeting wearing a gold ring and fine clothes, and a poor man in shabby clothes also comes in. If you show special attention to the man wearing fine clothes and say, 'Here's a good seat for you,' but say to the poor man, 'You stand there,' or 'Sit on the floor by my feet,' have you not discriminated among yourselves and become judges with evil thoughts? Listen, my dear brothers, has not God chosen those who are poor in the eyes of the world to be rich in faith and to inherit the kingdom he promised those who love him? But you have insulted the poor. Is it not the rich who are exploiting you? Are they not the ones who are dragging you into courts? Are they not the ones who are slandering the noble name of him to whom you belong? If you really keep the royal law found in Scripture, 'Love your neighbor as yourself,' you are doing right. But if you show favoritism, you sin and are convicted by the law as lawbreakers. For whoever keeps the whole law and yet stumbles at just one point is guilty of breaking all of it. What good is it, my brothers, if a man claims to have faith but has no deed? Can such faith save him? Suppose a brother or sister is without clothes and daily food. If one of you says to him, 'Go, I wish you well, keep warm and well fed,' but does nothing about his physical needs, what good is it? In the same way, faith by itself, if not accompanied by action, is dead. But someone will say, 'You have faith, and I have deeds.' Show me your faith without deeds, and I will show you my faith by what I do. You believe that there is one God. Good. Even the demons believe that and shudder." Would you please stand for the reading of the Holy Gospel here tonight? Our Gospel reading comes from Mark chapter 7, starting at verse 24. Jesus left that place, Gennesaret, and went to the vicinity of Tyre. He entered a house and did not want anyone to know it, yet he could not keep his presence secret. In fact, as soon as she heard about him, a woman whose little daughter was possessed by an evil spirit came and fell at his feet. The woman was a Greek, born in Syrian Phoenicia. She begged Jesus to drive the demon out of her. "First, let the children eat all they want," he told her, "for it is not right to take the children's bread and toss it to their dogs." "Yes, Lord," she replied, "but even the dogs under the table eat the children's crumbs." Then he told her, "For such a reply, you may go. The demon has left your daughter." She went home and found her child lying on the bed and the demon gone. Then Jesus left the vicinity of Tyre and went through Sidon, down to the Sea of Galilee and into the region of the Decapolis. There some people brought to him a man who was deaf and could hardly talk, and they begged him to place his hand on the man. After he took him aside, away from the crowd, Jesus put his fingers into the man's ears. Then he spit and touched the man's tongue. He looked up to heaven and with a deep sigh said to him, "Ephphatha," which means "be opened." At this, the man's ears were opened, his tongue was loosened, and he began to speak plainly. Jesus commanded them not to tell anyone, but the more he did so, the more they kept talking about it. People were overwhelmed with amazement. "He has done everything well," they said. "He even makes the deaf hear and the mute speak." This is our gospel reading for tonight. Please be seated. Heavenly Father, we thank you for the good works you have prepared for us, the good works which give evidence of our faith to the world around us, Lord, which is what you have called us to be, little Christs in the world, that we would shine the light of Jesus Christ here and now. Lord, tonight I ask that you would bless the words of my mouth and the meditations of each of our hearts. May it all be pleasing and acceptable in your sight. We pray in Jesus' name. Amen. I want to thank everybody who gave me a summer sermon request this year. You guys picked some challenging things. There was lots of challenging topics that we went over, but I believe that we have grown as the church in this growth season, this green season, grown in God's Word. Even though I thought I might be done with some of the more challenging parts of God's Word, the Holy Spirit had different plans for me. The epistle reading tonight, you might have noticed, this epistle reading kind of sticks out like a sore thumb, begging to be attended to, begging to be looked over and explained. In James chapter 2, God's Word tells us that faith, apart from works, is dead. Now, that should cause a fair amount of squirming in the seats for anybody who is a Christian, especially those who are of the Lutheran persuasion, that faith apart from any. Who here tonight feels that right now they could give a good answer of why this is, of what this means, and how it jives with all of the rest of God's Word? It's a challenging topic. It's a really hard one, but I want you to be able to tackle this topic and topics like this in God's Word. Because of the work of discipleship, the work of growing and sharpening our skills in the faith is what we are about in this time as the church with one another, especially in this season of growth. So here tonight is a great way to understand James chapter 2, the entire chapter, really. The first thing we need to recognize is this. Number one, we must know up front, the book of James is written for Christians who are maturing in the faith. The book of James is written for Christians who are maturing in the faith. Some New Testament books were written for those who were not yet Christians. Some New Testament books were written to those who were baby Christians. And some books were written to the church for the purposes of growing up into Him, who is our head, into Jesus, for the purposes of growing and maturing in the faith. The book of James is a clear example of the last one, of that last example. How do we know that it was written for those who are already Christians, for the purposes of strengthening and maturing in the faith? We know because of how it starts. James addresses his letter to the church, he says. In fact, he says to the true Israel that is dispersed and scattered all around. And he recognizes this right away in the first couple of verses of this book. "Many of you are suffering," he says. I recognize that. "Many of you are meeting trials and testing. And the smartest, wisest, best thing to do," he says, "is to ask God for wisdom." That's what the book of James is all about. I preached a sermon a while back in which I referred to James as the Proverbs of the New Testament. And I heard that from somebody else. We heard it from somebody else. That James is the Proverbs of New Testament. That is the book of wisdom for the New Testament. James, in in his letter is about the business of building up, of nurturing, nourishing, and preparing the church to be the body of Christ that God has indeed called us to be. And so in chapter 2, he says, this is one way to think about mature Christianity. We know in chapter 3, he says, watch your mouth, right? Tame your tongue, that's harder to do. In chapter 2, he says this is something else. He says, treat every single believer in Jesus like how they should be treated. Like that they are an heir of Christ. They are an heir to the kingdom. James chapter 2, verse 1, he says, my brothers, show no partiality as you hold the faith in our Lord Jesus Christ, the Lord of glory. This is an important statement because it lays the foundation for everything else James talks about in this chapter. Believe it or not, the church is today and has always been full of sinners. Yes, of course. The early church wasn't always treating each other the way they should. The poor and needy, we know, were being neglected. James talks about it. Paul certainly talks about it. The rich and powerful were receiving all of the honor. And James says this right here is a perfect example of this truth. The truth we're going to read here tonight is this, that faith without good works that should accompany that faith is nothing. In fact, it says it is dead. Now, Paul agrees with this statement, by the way, in 1 Corinthians chapter 13 by saying, if I know everything, if I have all knowledge, and I have a faith so strong that it can move mountains, but I don't have good works, he calls it love in this chapter, I am nothing, he says. Faith apart from good works is dead. And here is what makes all of the difference. This really unlocks what's going on in this passage here tonight. In this passage, James wants to distinguish mere knowledge from saving faith. I'll read it again. In this passage, James wants to distinguish mere knowledge of something from saving faith. In Greek, the word for knowing something and believing something is the same. Pistis. It's the same root word. It's translated faith. And in English, we do the same thing. It's much the same. You have, right, faith in Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior. And then we say, the Christian faith is that which is expressed in our creeds. We've then used faith in two ways. Theology has created a systematic to describe this. Probably can forget this after I say it. But don't forget what it means. Fides quae creditor means the faith that is believed. So these are all our tenets of faith. Everything in the creed. Everything we're going to express later on tonight. And then the second one is fides qua creditor, which means the faith that is believing. It is the active faith that we have. Now, these two things, the qua and the quai, the faith that is believed and the faith that means believing, these two things always, always, always go hand in hand. They absolutely must go together, cannot be separated. You can have all of the believing faith in the world, but have it in the wrong thing. You can have it in the wrong God, and then it amounts to nothing. There are, in fact, extremely devout people in this world that are horribly and woefully led astray by the contents of their faith. You can have a right God, understand the right tenets of the faith, have all these things and trust in these things above all. And then that faith amounts to nothing. This is the distinction James is making. How do I know? Because James says so in verse 19. Verse 19, which is the next verse after our assigned lectionary reading, says, "You believe that God is one." Good, he says. You do well. But even the demons believe that, he says, and it causes them to shudder. God is one, he said. Well, what is that? It's the oldest creed, really. The old school creed of Israel. The very knowledge of God. God is one, behold, Israel. James says that is good. You understand the creed. You understand the faith. But even the demons believe, Pastuo, even the demons believe that. In fact, Satan and all of his forces of evil are very clear on who God is, on who Jesus is, on what the Holy Spirit does. They, in fact, have a fuller understanding of that than you or me in this temporary time, in this temporary time. What they don't have is the faith that is believing. What they can't do is reach out for salvation, receive what Christ has won. Martin Luther was a lot of things. We know that. A theologian, he was a reformer, he was a teacher, he was a sharp-tongued curmudgeon, lots of times. But Number one, you ask anybody who really studies Martin Luther, number one, he was first and foremost a pastor. That's what he was. He was a very good pastor. And then he did other things too. And he says this, I think it's a very pastoral statement. He says this in regards to what saving faith is. Here's his quote. "It will profit you nothing to believe that Christ was delivered for the sins of other sins, and to doubt that he was delivered for your sins. For both the ungodly and demons believe this. No, you must take for granted in steadfast confidence that he was delivered for your sins too, that you are one of those for whose sins he was delivered. This faith justifies you." That is, makes you right with God. That is the faith that is believing. That is saving faith. That you deserve death and hell. And that Jesus climbed up upon the cross, gave us everything, and died for you and saved you, not just others. That's saving faith. And that saving faith gives evidence to the world, not what we know, but in what we do. Only saving faith can enact in someone, visible changes, the acts of love that Jesus says the people of this world will know me by, will know who you are, know who you belong to, and thus attribute what you do to me. And then James says, here's a great example. He does give a really good example, verses 15 through 17. He says, "If a brother or sister is poorly clothed and lacking in daily food, and one of you says to them, 'Go in peace, be warmed and filled,' without giving them the things needed for the body, what good is that? So also faith by itself, if it does not have works, is dead. And in case you haven't noticed, Christians, this is what we Christians have been criticized for in recent years. That we are quick to send thoughts and prayers in a time of suffering, but slow to do anything substantial." Have you ever heard that? I know I have. Now, part of that criticism criticism doesn't understand the power of prayer. Now, this part, they don't understand it. But part of it speaks the painful truth. We should never be the people who simply say, God bless you, be warmed and filled, and then don't do anything to warm and feed people. A believing faith produces works. Good works. Period. That's the way it works. A believing faith produces good works. Just like Jesus says, just like a good tree produces good fruit. It's inevitable. It happens. James says, faith by itself, faith that knows a lot, but does nothing, faith that is meticulously orthodox and right in every aspect of its systematic theology, but does not do the work of the church, that faith is dead. Somebody who is dead can be saved. Thanks be to Jesus Christ. Thanks be to his resurrection. Somebody who is dead can be saved. But somebody who is dead cannot do anything for anybody else. So as a Christian, here is the best way to think of faith and good works. I think this is a pretty good way. For the Christian, good works are necessary, but not for salvation. For the Christian, good works are necessary, but not for salvation. The second part of that, my friends, does not negate the first part of that. It just does not. Good works absolutely are necessary. That statement for us needs to be revisited over and over and over again. Why? Because it never lets us off the hook. You are not saved by your works, but those works are necessary. They are not optional. They are commanded by the Lord of the church, Jesus Christ. And when you fail and fall short of those good works, your salvation is secure in Christ, but you cannot ever, for any reason, cast aside, neglect, reject the good works. This, my friends, is the Christian life. And it's not always easy. And it's not always comfortable. And I believe that's what Jesus said it would be like. James has one final point to hit on in our epistle reading tonight. He says this in verse 18. Hey, this is going to happen. And it does. He says, someone will say, you have faith and I have works. And he says this. He says, show me your faith apart from your works. And I will show you my faith by my works. Now, why does he say this? This is the unfortunate reality of a faith without works. It is dead in that it does not produce the fruit of the Holy Spirit. It is dead in that it does not shine the light of Christ. It is dead in that it does not extend the love of God. It does not allow for people to see your good deeds and give glory to your Father who is in heaven. The truth is, it is very, very hard, I don't want to use the word impossible, but it is very, very hard to show somebody your faith apart from works. There is a lot of truth to the statement, people don't care how much you know until they know how much you care. There is simply truth in that. Mere knowledge and intellectual assent does nothing for those outside of you. But saving faith, faith that brings you to the foot of the cross, not just once or twice, but like every day, saving faith, faith which clings to the promises of God, always produces good works. This is how it works. This is how God designed it to be. And the good works that God created for us, and we heard that verse from Ephesians 2:10, the one we often leave off, for by grace you have been saved through faith. This is not your own doing. It's a gift of God, not a result of works, so that no one may boast. For you are God's workmanship, created in Christ. in them. The good works that God created us for, these give evidence to the world of the salvation that lives in us. Brothers and sisters, I pray that we would be people of faith, strong people of faith. Let us hold fast to the faith that is believed, to the creeds, to the truth and the faith of our fathers that have been handed down faithfully to us. Let us produce the good works also of faith that is believing. Good works that have nothing to do with our salvation, but may have a whole lot to do with somebody else's. Those who have not seen and heard the goodness of Jesus Christ, which lives in us, but is also for the world. Let our faith be alive as we live, as we suffer, as we die, as we daily rise with Christ. May we walk in the good works that God has prepared for us and has recreated for us to live in. Amen. May the peace of God, which surpasses all understanding, guard your hearts and minds in Christ Jesus, our Lord. Lord Jesus, we give you great thanks for the good works that have been prepared for us to do, so that we might start now in small, imperfect ways, conforming ourselves to the image of Christ, and therefore be brought to completion on that day that you bring us into your kingdom. Lord, we ask that you would enable us over and over to look at the faith and the good works that is a part of our life, Lord, that we might produce fruit in keeping with repentance, that we might produce fruit that leads others to know you. Lord, we give you thanks for this call and this opportunity we have daily. We pray that you would enable us to do all things. We pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. Let's stand and sing.
Thank you.
Heavenly Father, in holy baptism, you have caused waters to break forth in the wilderness and made streams in the desert of this world. Open our eyes to the new life in Christ and our ears to hear your word. Free us to walk uprightly and loose our tongues to praise you for this treasure. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Heavenly Father, you have made us all heirs of your kingdom through holy baptism, holding the faith in our Lord Jesus Christ, the Lord of glory. Keep us from showing partiality and making distinctions among ourselves, and make us rich in good works. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayers.
Heavenly Father, create and sustain in us a lively faith in Christ Jesus, and lead us by your Holy Spirit to be active in all good works that you have prepared for us. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Heavenly Father, help parents to raise up their children to know you as their help and their hope, that they may not put their trust in princes in whom there is no salvation. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Heavenly Father, we place our hope in you and ask your blessing on all rulers, that their plans would be ordered for the welfare of those they govern, and that you would execute your justice for the oppressed at all times. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Heavenly Father, behold graciously the sick and those in any type of need. Lord, today we ask that you would continue to be with Mary and Clark Halberg, Lord, as they are both recovering from COVID. We thank you for their improvement. We ask that you would continue to bless them in this time. We also bring before you the Thornhills, Lisa and Wade, also both recovering from COVID. I know they're doing a lot better in this time, Lord. We ask that you would bring their healing to completion. We thank you for what you have done. Lord, we ask that you would be with Stephen Dabson, prayers for success in an upcoming knee surgery that he will probably need. Lord, we ask that you would be with him in this time, relieve his pain. For the D'Elia family, Lord, friends of our preschool families, as they mourn the passing of Mario from cancer, Lord, we ask that you would bless that family and give them comfort and peace in this time. We ask that you would also be with the Springsteads, Lord, at the passing of Jody's mother, Judy Shannon. Lord, we ask that you would bring a peace that passes understanding, a hope in the resurrection found in Christ Jesus. And as they get prepared for memorial service next week, Lord, that you would comfort them in your arms. Be with our brother Sterling Grant, Lord, who's suffering some severe left knee pain. We ask that you would alleviate that pain, Lord, that he would get the referral he needs to get an x-ray, see what's going on with that. We ask that you would be with all people according to their needs. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Heavenly Father, grant that all who come to the Lord's Supper this day would do so in repentance and faith for the forgiveness of sins and in the unity of a true confession. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
All these things and whatever else you know that we need, grant us, Father, for the sake of him who died and rose again, and now lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever.
Amen.
The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Come to the table the Lord has prepared for you. With faith in his promise of the forgiveness of sins, and in his assurance that his body and blood are present.
We thank and praise the Lord for his mercy and grace.
Our Lord Jesus Christ, on the very same night that he was betrayed, took bread. After giving thanks, he broke it, giving it to his disciples and saying, "Take and eat, this is my body given for you. Do this in the remembrance of me." In the same way also when supper had ended, he took the cup. Giving thanks once again, he gave it to them, saying, "Drink of it, all of you. This cup is the New Testament in my blood, shed for you for the forgiveness of all of your sins. Do this as often as you drink of it, in the remembrance of me." O Lord, remember us in your kingdom, and teach us to pray.
Our Father, who art in heaven,
hallowed be thy name.
Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen.
May these gifts of the true body and blood of your Lord and Savior Jesus Christ strengthen you in body and in soul to life everlasting. Depart from his peace, sins forgiven. Amen. May God be gracious to you and bless you. May he cause his face to shine upon you, and may he make all grace abound to you, so that always, having all sufficiency in everything, you may have an abundance for every good work.
Amen. Amen.
And I invite you to stand as you are able for our final song, Jesus Messiah. Thanks be to God.